class, I will talk about the final project that you'll have to do in the final weeks of this course. It counts towards half of your grade, so it's quite important. And it'll be the final answer to the questions that that lead this course. So we start with what information should look like when we share it between machines, how to answer questions from it, how to prevent miscommunication, and connect and integrate different information sources. And then the final question is how to build an application based on all this information. And that's what the final project is about. So we build a semantic web application. And that involves several steps to make it successful. For starters, you look at what data you need for your application and make a selection from that. And if the data is not yet RDF, then you transform it to RDF. And there are several tools for this and methods. And we will provide these tools and methods in due time. So we'll show you how to use some of these tools so that you can use them in building your semantic web application. And the reason is we want to do some inferencing and answer some questions, present some new knowledge. And then if we have this this knowledge in your application, publish it so that people can reuse it in the spirit of the semantic web, basically. And building this application in general has a standard architecture. So first we look at the data sources, which can be a Sparkle endpoint from which you can get data, or you get data from DBpedia. So you get a DBpedia dump of a subset of its data, maybe some instances from various classes, or you take comma separated values from an Excel sheet, or you get some SQL, some data from a SQL database, and then you integrate this and you link it, and then you put it in your own database. So probably you'll use Stardock. And once you have this integrated knowledge, you can then query the Stardock endpoint using Sparkle, and your semantic web application will use the query results to have a nice presentation of this data and do something useful. And you might also create an application that alters Sparkle queries based on user input, so you have some nice user interaction. So let's look at this architecture in more detail. So we can have different technologies to make our semantic web application work. And you have the option to choose for many different technologies during your final project. So if you, you're not very keen on programming in Python, which you did before, you can also use different languages. For storing your data, you probably use Stardock Triple Store for starters, but then you can also have a database running next to that, or file system. And you can also do some SQL queries in between and make use of your Stardock Sparkle endpoint and maybe integrate it with other HTTP services, so some APIs on the internet. Then for the application layer, the semantic web app should be something that runs in your browser. So you have server-side and client-side scripting, and you are very free in your choice of what programming language or scripting language you'll use. So you can use Java, JavaScript, PHP, Python, which you used before, C#, etc. There are also RDF libraries and for PHP for you to use. So that is a viable option. And then for presenting your semantic web application to users, so at client side, you use HTML and CSS to have a nice user interface. And later on, I'll explain the grading of the final project in more detail. So then you can also be creative in your solution, very creative. And the grading is not only on how well you program, but also on how well you have this user interaction and how well you describe the domain and the scope of your application. So if you're not very good in programming, you can still get a lot of points. And if you're very good in programming but less good in user interface design, then also you can get a lot of points. So there is a lot of leeway and a lot of creativity you can put in the final project. So for you to get started, we already have a project step, the Semantic Web Application tutorial on GitHub. This is also the same repository from which you got the description of how to install your tool, but this your tools, and this repository is also for getting the right tools and installing the right libraries and frameworks for getting the semantic web example to run. So this is a step for a semantic web application, and you can fork this project and then extend it to have your own project based on this basic layer of code that's already there. You can also do it yourself, so you do it from scratch in any programming language you want. So this might be easier if you're not very good in Python, and also for people who are very bad in web development and coding, you can use many libraries and use external hosting. So you can host your semantic web application on, for example, GitHub, which runs client-side JavaScript, or on Google Sites, for example. You use some libraries and that connect to your Sparkle endpoint of your RDF store, or you just include your link data in a file there, and you have some method of accessing that. And you use SVGistler to visualize your data in a nice way that's fitting for your application design or any other library, maybe also D3, or you may use tree.js if you want to have a nice 3D application. So you can be very creative. So this third option will involve less coding and will be a bit easier, so you probably get less credits for the programming part. But then again, if you have a very nice solution in doing this, you might end up with more credits on other parts. So you get more points for a nice user interface or a very good ontology or very good reuse of your data. And there is again another example for the final project on this link, which I'll also post next to this video. So the semantic web example. So for your final project, you will you build a semantic web application, and you'll reuse the ontology that you built in module 4, which you'll then integrate with another student's ontology. And you'll work in teams of three. So you'll have three ontologies. So you have many different options to choose from. So your ontologies can cover various domains, and you can extend the domain based on ontologies that are already out there on the internet. So if you have an ontology on geography, and you want to make a semantic web application that involves both geography and population statistics, you might get data from the Central Bureau of Statistics, and you might have an ontology that fits for those statistics. And then your application would be show me statistics, demographics about a certain region, for example. So you'll reuse the ontology you have been building. Once you have created the application, you should provide the code, and then an easy method for this is just posting it on GitHub, which is free and easily accessible, and it has version management. And you have to provide a screencast of the end result. And at the end of this video lecture, I'll give you a post a link to a screencast that is from a good project from last year. So you'll know, and it's also a good screencast, so you'll know what a screencast should look like. So all these goals that we discussed during previous video lectures, using Sparkle, making your unlinked data, making ontology, integrate your data with that of others, and publish your unlinked data on the web, these will all be covered by the final project. So in the final project, these things all come together. So you'll have to use Sparkle, create an ontology, integrate different data sets, and publish your linked data on the web. So to go into a bit more detail, during the final project, we design a semantic web application, we implement it, and then also an important part is to write a professional report on the application and its purpose, explaining how it is constructed, because you have lots of different parts that you need to get together. So you have different data sources, different ontologies, then you store it somewhere, and then you query it. So you must provide some Sparkle queries to show how you access your data and how you make selections and filters and groupings. And then also you have to explain your design decisions. So this is also related to the theory of the course, because during your explanation of design decisions, you'll have to reason why you model the ontology in a certain way, or why you think a certain Sparkle query is a good idea, and how you use your data, and why you chose a certain data set or data representation. So a good tip during the final project would be to explicitly record your design decisions on the go. So you have a notebook next to you, and you write down what you do and why you do it. And a very important criteria for the final project is that you can be, but you also have to be creative. So you have to build something original and something nice. So that shows how linked data can be used to an advantage in semantic web applications. So with regards to organization, during the final project, we'll have three milestones before you submit the entire project at the end. And these milestones, they follow each other 1 week after another, about 1 week after another. So first you have to give a short report on how you did domain modeling. So you have some idea for what you want to do with the application, a very initial idea, but then you also need to have an appropriate ontology for the information need of your application. So you do domain modeling, and this is very much related to the ontology engineering lecture also this week in module 5, in which you look at the domain of your application and the scope and possible users and competency questions. Then the next milestone is about data reuse. So once you have modeled your domain, part of the information that you'll use will be reused from sources on the internet. So existing ontologies, existing vocabularies maybe, and also existing data sets that might be in PDF or MS Word or Excel or comma separated value files. And you will have to describe how you do this in the second milestone, data reuse. And then the third milestone is a final application design. So you describe what the application should look like, and you have some mockups of views and screens in your application. And we'll go now into a bit more detail in these milestones, and they will lead up to the final project report. So you can reuse them in your final project report. So for domain modeling, you first start identifying the goal of the application. Again, you define a domain and a scope like you do in ontology engineering. And then you provide a conceptualization. So you identify the concepts in your in the domain of your application. So classes and properties. Then you provide an actual L representation. So you might have a nice diagram of the concepts in your application and how they link together. And then you actually make this representation in L as a turtle file, basically. So you add the classes in L, you add class axioms, you create relationships between the classes, you create maybe some example instances to check if your ontology works, if it's consistent, and if there are no contradictions. And then also you reuse existing ontologies. So you might reuse the DBpedia ontology, and maybe you reuse geonames. And these reused ontologies should then come back in your ontology. So they should be referenced somehow. So these are the steps you have to do. And then in the report, or which you will send to us, your reporting of this milestone, you will have to describe the application. So the goal and the domain and scope. You provide a drawing of the conceptualization. So just a box and line diagram of what you, how you design your domain, what you think are important concepts in a domain and how they relate to each other. And then because you have made an L representation with axioms and property types and restrictions, you also show that this R representation is capable of inferencing. So indeed, you will have to create some example instances to show that inferences are being made. And the serialization of the ontology, basically, this is the ontology file itself in Turtle. So you save it as Turtle and you upload it on Canvas for this milestone. Then the second milestone, you will have to choose external data sources, more than two. So these can be relational databases, and then you apply a relational database to RDF mapping, or these can be comma separated values, and then again you do a transformation that is similar to relational database to RDF mappings, or you use an existing linked data source, maybe from the laundromat. You motivate why you choose these external data sources, and you do the conversion, ingestion, alignment, and merging of the external data sources. You adapt your ontology to handle these data sources to make sure that the schema, the schema level can handle your data that you got from the external data sources. And again, you perform some inferencing over the new data sources. So for the deliverable, the description of the milestone that you'll send to us, you'll have to give a revised description of the application. So once you have these external data sources, your application might become slightly different. Maybe because you cannot answer certain competency questions, or you have a new ID that works better, or the previous ID didn't work well. Then motivating the data, the choice of data sources, which is also here in the steps you have to take. Then some examples of queries in your application that you'll use. So queries to answer the competency questions, queries that you will again reuse in your actual application to show data to your users. And some evidence that you inferred new facts from the current ontology plus dataset that you're using. And then in the next milestone, you have to finalize your application design. So you have to define the application and its users in great detail. You define views on the data. So maybe you you have different users and you have different views for each users. Maybe, for example, domain experts and people who are not experts. And you'll have different screens in your application. So you can create mockups for each of the different dialogues and screens, or basically web pages that you'll show to your users. And you will make sure that the data is reusable. So you will probably have to create some metadata description, so RDFS labels to describe what your classes actually do, the classes in your ontology, and what properties do, what they mean. So in the report for this milestone, you give a final description of the application, a description of the user base, so the expected users or the intended users. For example, if you have an application that explains astronomy to elementary school children, then you say our user base consists of elementary school children, and they need to learn about distances of planets and their temperature. So you can describe in great detail the information need that they have. And this information need will also be the competency questions for your ontology, basically. So your ontology must be able to answer these questions. Then a description of the views on your data. So you might also have the teachers of the elementary school that need to get some more information, maybe to do an introductory presentation once elementary school students use your application. And again, a description of your data reuse and the inferencing that is possible. So these milestones will be submitted before the end of the project. And at the end of the project, you'll also deliver the final report at the final deadline. And in this report, you can reuse material from the previous, from the milestones, the three milestones. And in the final report, it's quite important to show what you've learned. So you have some reflection on how the project went, what went well, what did not went so good. You have to make the report well organized and clearly written. So if it's not well organized and not clearly written, you lose points, basically. You need to clearly present the semantic web application. And this is partially done in the report, but more on the underlying level, showing what technologies you've used and how you've used them. And you have to justify your design choices. So you say you write that you have chosen for a certain class hierarchy, and then you have to motivate why this is good, and maybe why you did not choose for an alternative class hierarchy. So the report should be professional, should be 8 to 12 pages, and it should include a link to a working prototype. So you host your code on GitHub, such that we can run it, or you host it on a hosting service on Google Sites, for example. And on GitHub, you can both host code if it's only in JavaScript and HTML, or you can just post the code there in a repository. And if we then pull this repository, we might be able to host your application on our local host. So this is the goal, that at least we can get your application running. And additionally, you have to make a screencast, so you make a video of your application in which you show its features. So you show that this is the application, this is the goal, it has certain views and screens, and you explain a little bit of how link data is used and how it's presented, and you show the application as a user would use it. So you both explain it and you show typical usage. So the milestones and final report look like a lot of work, but we'll give you a detailed description of what should be in there. So you'll have some guidelines to work with. And later on in the next few slides, I'll also discuss the evaluation of the final project and also the milestones and final report. So you have a better idea of what to focus on when building on the Semantic Web Application. And next to the requirements that I've already outlined, so you use some ontologies and you reuse some existing data, you can get extra points by completing extra challenges, and you get honorary titles such as the Link Data Star. So if you are a Link Data Star, you will publish your ontology and your data as a new data set that has added value for others. So you need to have added value by first describing how your ontology works. So you describe the classes and the properties. You map to other data sources. So maybe you link to DBpedia, such that other people on the internet can reuse your ontology for their purpose. And then a link data producer is an honorary title if you not just reuse the existing semantic data, but also add data from sources that are not yet linked data, not yet triples. So if you use a relational database and you convert it to triples, to RDF, or you take an Excel sheet or maybe even a PDF file and you convert it to a triple format and you integrate it into your ontology and knowledge base, republish it as RDF, you also get extra points. And then if you have a very nice ontology, if you are a wizardly owl master, then you also get extra points. So if your ontology is very rich and expressive, if you derive non-trivial results, then you also get extra points. And again, for people that are not very good at programming or find Protégé and OWL very difficult, you can also get extra points if you have a very nice application design, user interface design. So if you are an interaction guru and your application is visually appealing and very interactive and very innovative and cool, then you also get extra points. So there is a lot of leeway in how you get awarded points, and you can be very creative in what you do, and you can focus on the things that you are best at. So the final project, the major evaluation points are that you have a presentation, a report, you have some use of technology and some use of data. So these are the major evaluation points. And the general rule of thumb is that you have to be clear on what you write. You have to be concise. So don't write stuff because you need to fill up pages. So you better write a concise, short explanation of what you did, as opposed to a very long story that contains irrelevant information. Also be concrete. So directly state facts as they are. Do not use long stories again to explain something that can be, for example, explained by just copy pasting in a Sparkle query or a triple. And be creative. So the more creative you are, the more points you'll get for various aspects. So if you're very creative in your UI design, you get extra points. If you're very creative in your ontology, you also get extra points. So this is a good thing to do. So think carefully about the use of your application, the novelty, and the things that are uniquely yours. And we will use a rubric to grade your final project. And all the evaluation criteria that I just outlined, they come back in this rubric. And even if you do not adhere to some of the strict criteria, for example, you do not have 3 external data sources but 2, you can still get some points. So let's go through the rubric. So for starters, for the report organization layout and language of your final report, we have 4 levels of proficiency. So if there is no report, you'll get no points, obviously. If you are graded as being a novice in writing this report, you only get 2 out of 10 points. So if the report is not well organized, if it has very long paragraphs, no clear section structure, if it's hard to read, the language is insufficient, then you get less points. If you're very good at it, if you have a very clear and coherent story, you'll get maximum points. Then more specific, in this final report you'll describe the application and its users. And then if you have no description of the application and its users, then you get 0 points. If you describe the application and in such a way that it's clear what it's intended to do, why it is a useful application, then you get some points. But if it's too long and the users are not very well described, or if there are some unclarities, you'll get less than 10 points, so you only get 6 out of 10 points. If you you have a very good application design and walkthrough, you'll give a detailed description of the design of the application, the views of the data, you have a very clear walkthrough of a typical usage scenario, so how a user would use your application, what things he or she can click on, what the result will be, and then you'll get a lot of points. So this description should be consistent with your application description. So the walkthrough to a typical use scenario should be consistent with how you intend your application to be, how you motivate it. You have to provide good proper screenshots and all the ways in which you you make this description of your application very clear and concise and compelling. And if you have a marginal discussion of your application design and you have maybe no typical usage scenario, then you get only 2 out of 10 points. The domain and conceptualization is a description of the domain of your ontology and its scope. And then if you describe it very detailed, so for example, you make a semantic web application about geography, then you say, we have these concepts, we have countries and cities, and we use them, we include them because the user has an information need for these concepts and the relationships between them. And if you describe the methodology in how you constructed your domain model and your ontology, you'll also get, so this is required to get a maximum amount of points, so 10 out of 10. And if your ontology, your domain model, your conceptualization corresponds to the actual domain. So if you have a semantic web application, an ontology about geography, and if it's consistent with that actual domain, you will also you will get the maximum amount of points for this. Ontology and inferencing is a very important grading criteria. So you can see that max you get 20 points, But if you have no ontology and no inferencing discussed in your report, you even get minus points. So this is 3 out of 10 points will be about whether you have a proper ontology, whether it has a lot of expressiveness, and whether the inferences are properly described, and whether the inferences are relevant. So if your inferences are very limited, so only inverse of and transitivity, then you will only get points for being competent. So you get 11 out of 20 points. Then there is lots of leeway in this grading, in this rubric. So if you do have inferences and you show the ontology, but the inferences are not applied to external data, you also not get full points. So you only get 11 out of 20. So you get max points if you have a very expressive ontology, if it plays an important role in the application. So if its inferences are not trivial and if it's very expressive, you provide screenshots of inferences. And if you show good understanding of how these inferences are produced. So you maybe write a few paragraphs about how inferences are made in your ontology and how they relate to your actual application. So what they are used for and how they are useful. Or maybe they are useful because you import external data, and then using the inferences in the ontology, you do not have to classify all the imported data by hand. And then for data reuse, one of the criteria during, I think, milestone 2 data reuse is that you use more than 2 external data sources. So if you do not use any external data sources, you get 0 points for this criteria. So you do not fail the project, you only lose 1 out of 10 points. If you use at least 2 data sets, of which one is from Sparkle, but they are not very well described, and the data set, the choice of your data set is not clearly motivated, then you get 6 out of 10 points. And then if it is clearly motivated, and one is access to a Sparkle endpoint, you'll get max points. And then there's also the Sparkle queries, which you have, they need to be sufficiently complex, there need to be multiple, and they need to use some advanced features like aggregates, filter optionals, complex filters, external service calls, property paths, and then you get max points. Then again, the final criteria is that you have the functionality of the application. If the application doesn't work or no proof is provided, then you get 0 points. If the application works, is very functional, and supports the goal that you claim it has at the start of the report. So if it can answer the competency questions and it can support your users, and if the interface is very attractive, well designed, you'll get max points. And you can get even more points if the if you are a UI guru, if you make an interface that is very interactive. So you get these on top of these 10 points. You'll get even more points if you make very nice user interaction. And also for example, ontology and inferencing, if you have a very, very expressive ontology and it makes very nice inferences, you might even get more than 20 points. You get extra points on top of the 20 points. So these are the extra challenges for which you can get graded. All right, so these were the rubrics, the evaluation of your final project. And then I'll show some examples of final projects from previous years. I'll show the final reports and give a bit of insights in how you can properly report on your application, and some examples of nice application designs. So I'll use 3 projects. Reaching for the Stars, one that's about living in different cities, and one that is about a platform for pets. and I'll show the final reports. And then for Reaching for the Stars, I'll also link to a screencast of this the finished application. So I will first show the final reports of a semantic web application called Pet Platform. So this is the final project of a group of students from last year, and they have a nice logo and their student names. They have an index, so a table of contents, and this table of contents corresponds to different milestones and describes the various aspects of the final project. So a short introduction, and as you can read here that our first idea was to create an application to combine all bachelor studies which you can apply for from all universities in the Netherlands. And this is an idea that they did not pursue, so in the end they decided for something else. So they instead they built a semantic web application about adaptation of pets, so cats and dogs, and they found a data set that was useful for this. So they then described the goal of the application, so goal, users, and walkthrough. So the goal is to match a person with an adoptable pet he or she would like, or allow users to find a lost or found pet. And this will be done by matching the preference of the person with features of the non-adoptable pet. So they provide a list and they have some data. So they first describe the domain, the methodology, a sketch of the conceptualization, and the ontology itself. So this is a sketch of the concepts. So of the initial idea of having bachelor studies and having different educations and different disciplines, but they didn't pursue this. So instead they also show the diagram that is used in the conceptualization of their domain that is used in their actual final application, which is about animals, adoptable pets, non-adoptable pets, different kinds of pets, or rabbits, birds, rodents, dogs. And they have a diagram of the conceptualization that is generated from Protégé. So this is also fine because it shows the class hierarchy. So then some more description on why this is a good classification. And then a screenshot of inferences being made based on the color values of animals. A description of the data sets. So they got the data from data.gov and they post a link to the actual data set, to the prefixes of the data set. So this is good for traceability. And then a description of how this reused data set and its taxonomy, how it is used in their application and how they integrated it. Then some Sparkle queries used in their application, possibly to answer their competency questions. Also a screenshot of something that did not go well. So this is also important. So maybe something was not possible, so they had to choose an alternative. And these design decisions, they show us that you understand what you're doing. So it's important to tell us this. Another Sparkle query with a filter. So you have to have some several Sparkle queries that that are complex in order to get maximum points for this aspect. So another Sparkle query and the link to their working application. And description of the web application, some code, and even some references. So this is a final project about different cities to live and work. So first an introduction, which also motivates the application. It says finding the right spot where you can work effectively and which suits your needs can be a hassle. So apparently there is a problem that needs to be solved. So the goal of the application is to provide a user-friendly interface in which users can look for places to work, eat and sleep in close vicinity in a city of their choosing. So this is a very clear goal. And then a description of the users of the application is people who like to work during traveling. And then a description of the data that's being used, a domain description and the scope. And then a description of the ontology and some concepts. So places such as region, country, city and street. And then a description of the steps that the students who worked on this project took, which is nice for us to read how they went about and how they applied ontology engineering methodology. And then a conceptualization with classes, properties, a link to an appendix in which the classes can be seen. So here also a table is used, which is also an intuitive overview. So data from several external data sources. So DBpedia, GeoNames, SCOS, the Simple Knowledge Organization System, Yago, and NomadList, where DBpedia has a Sparkle endpoint, and then GeoNames doesn't have a Sparkle endpoint, but it's linked data. NomadList is not linked data, so they had to convert this to triples. So this is a very clear overview of the different data sources that they use in their application. And did some inferencing. They have some example queries that are shown in an appendix. And they show what is being retrieved. So I want to find something in where the minimum internet download speed is 20 megabytes per second and the total population of 500,000 people. And then their application design. First, the visual design with mockups from Dwarl.io. They can be found in some appendix. Some technical design, a walkthrough, which says that you have in the top right corner, you can make your own Sparkle queries. And then there is some lists and results, some tabs, and a link to the screencast on Vimeo, and a link to the source code on GitHub. And then a discussion on how the project went and some references. So this is the appendix in which the domain conceptualization is described. Some Sparkle queries. Again, more Sparkle queries that are used in their Stardock instance. And a complete overview of their class hierarchy and mockups for their user interface. And then the final user interface, how it looks like. And this is the final example I'll show you. This was a very good group from last year. They made an application, semantic web application, about astronomy, about planets and stars. And they made a very nice user interface. So I'll show you the final project. And then also I will provide a link to the screencast of the application in use. So they have a nice cover for the report, a quote with a nice with the person who made this quote, then a table of contents with application design, domain modeling, data reuse and queries. So these correspond to the milestones. So in your final report, you can reuse a lot of writings from your milestones, and an evaluation, so a reflection on how the project went and the design decisions you made. So a generic introduction, the application design saying that the target group would be people who want to know more about astronomy and compare different stars and planets. A description of the users, the design of the application with some mockups, and well, these are actual screenshots from the application. A walkthrough of how somebody, a typical user, would use their application. Some more screenshots. Then a domain model. First the domain and scope, and competency questions, which is very good because then you can check whether your final ontology is suitable for your application, for the information need of your application. And then a simple diagram that shows the class hierarchy. Then in more detail, the ontology class restrictions and the ontologies that were reused. Some screenshots of inferences. So a screenshot with the reasoner being off and the reasoner being on. Data reuse, so external sources. And the queries being used, so they reused DBpedia material, then Wikidata, which has a Sparkle endpoint, and Link Geodata, which is useful for having an astronomy application, because Link Geodata provides space dimensions in space, like astronomical units, which are units of the distance between stars and planets. Then the motivation of why these sources were selected. A lot of text about how this data would be was integrated in the Semantic Web application. And this is good because it's not trivial to integrate data. It is good to give a proper description of this. So for example, they have a telescope and observatory part of the application, and they used JS maps and AM charts. Note JS map, which is made by AM charts. So this is a map that shows, this is a library that visualizes coordinates stored as triples on a map. And this is then something that is very nice to show to users of the application. Some more details about hitboxes and how JavaScript is used and inner HTML is used. Then some Sparkle queries. As you can see, these Sparkle queries are put together with the HTML of the application. Then inferences being made, and screenshots of Starduck with and without the reasoner, or with the reasoner enabled and with the reasoner disabled. And then an evaluation about what went well and what they learned. So I hope this gives you a good overview of what to expect when working on the final project, how it's evaluated, and gives you some ideas about your own Semantic Web application. What would be a nice design, and what to think of when you work on it. That's it. Take a look at the screencast of this last group, Reaching for the Stars. It's quite nice to view. So good luck with your project once you start. Thanks.